Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and thank you for taking the time to be with us today. My name is Hegrif Khaitan and I am a partner in the corporate private equity and M&A practice at Khaitan & Company. On behalf of the firm, I would like to extend to each of you a very warm welcome to this webinar, whether you are in India or abroad. This is the second webinar in our M&A series in 2024. We have had an excellent program till now based on feedback from participants and have been thrilled with the tremendous response to the first webinar in this year's M&A Master Series, with literally thousands of registrations for webinars across the series. We are very grateful for the interest and support which our clients, associates and others have shown. We look forward to your participation and organizing promising webinars in 2024. On this slide is the agenda for today's webinar. In short, the format will be a discussion between our expert panel, followed by Q&A session with audience questions. We have already received several audience questions, and if you do have questions, please submit them using the facility provided in the webinar portal. If we cannot cover all the questions on in the webinar, we will respond offline by email after the webinar. Also, please note that after the webinar, you will receive a copy of the presentation, summary notes of the key issues discussed, and a link to the recording of this webinar. Today, we will discuss the outlook for M&A in 2024. After a record 2022 and a strong 2023 in M&A, when many of the world's developed economies were in the doldrums, there is much optimism around 2024. However, there remain significant domestic and international risks and uncertainties which could potentially impact the Indian M&A market. Macro and micro economic forces at play internationally are playing havoc in developed countries. On the international front, inflation and high interest rates seem to be expected for most of 2024. Whilst ongoing wars in Ukraine and the Middle East are having an adverse impact generally and have the potential to escalate. In India, we are facing an election year, the results of which will most certainly impact the economy and the M&A market one way or the other. Whilst our economy is strong and we are living in uncertain and volatile times, which makes our discussion today on the outlook for M&A in India very important. Every person who has registered for this webinar today has already received an email with full particulars of the credentials of our panel. So I will not spend much time repeating or summarizing their experience. Suffice to say, they are all experts in their fields, with excellent credentials and knowledge on Indian M&A activity. We are very fortunate today to have three experts on our panel, namely S. Sundareswaran, Managing Director and Head of India M&A Morgan Stanley, Naveen Vadhwani, Managing Director and Head of Investment Banking JP Morgan India, Prasanjit Chakravarti, my partner at Khaitan & Co. So now let us bring our expert panel members.
Thank you, Hegri. Always a pleasure to be speaking with you and to be a part of this series.
So let's...
thank you, Hegri, for inviting us. And it's a pleasure to be associated with this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you to both of you. So let's start off, with a question to both of you, Sundar and Naveen. How do you see the Indian economy performing in 2024-25? And how do you think this will impact M&A activity in India?
So I agree, when we look at the economy, I mean, and a lot of this should be pretty obvious for people who are looking at the markets around, right? I mean, a lot of things seem to be working very much in favor of India. After a long period of time, we think there are three or four vectors from an Indian economy perspective which seem to be all firing at the same time. When we look at banks in India, they're arguably as well capitalized as they have been in a long time. Private capex seemingly is picking up. Public capex has been a big driver. And when you sort of look at the overall environment, the geopolitics, India continues to be a sweet spot in the global economy. People want to increase their exposure to India. Private equities are active. And all the local corporates are probably sitting on a balance sheet, which is much stronger than what they have ever been in a long time. So there is very little you could argue against why things should not be a very strong year, or hopefully years ahead from an India M&A perspective. Valuations in India have always been punchy, but you need to sort of look at it in the context of the growth which Indian markets will deliver. But otherwise, we think we are in probably for not just a sweet year, but probably a few years ahead of sustained M&A activity.
Yeah, no, so thank you, Sundar. I think I will just add to what just Sundar said is I think we are, as a country, in my view, in a very, very unique and a differentiated position to things what Sundar said. I would just add, I think the whole India digital stack, the whole digital transformation at scale that has happened, I think is giving us a very serious, you know, push, impetus, which is bottom up, which was not the case earlier. So the whole pan-India 4G penetration, the way we transact, the way we borrow, the way we lend, the way the consumers are transacting, all that has significantly changed in the last 2 to 3 years. And I think that lever cutting across all sectors is giving a big push of growth. So that is one. The second thing, I think this whole Make in India and then China plus one and Euro plus one whole approach is also giving that confidence to the Indian corporates and a lot of financial sponsors who are wanting to deploy capital in India on developing the assets is giving a big impetus. So that, I think, is the second important thing I would like to add. The third thing, I think, which is also very visible now is the infrastructure spend that the government is doing. Now, all that leads to, you know, productivity gain in terms of the entire cascading benefits of the economic growth. Plus, I think geopolitically, as Sundar also mentioned, I think we are at an absolutely differentiated spot with what's happening between US, China, US, Russia, Ukraine, then what's happening in now West Asia. Clearly, investors really have no other alternative but to kind of look at India as a place to invest. So I think when you put all of that together and then when you on top of that see deep financial markets right now, if you speak, our capital markets are at $4.5 trillion, you know, valuation. While one may argue that these are, you know, punchy valuations, but at the same time, we have, if you look at the last 3-4 years, we have been kind of at those kind of price to earning multiples because we've been able to have our earnings growth. So all these levers, when you look at it, and of course, we have always been a consumption led economy, so that continues. Services has been a very strong play for us. So we are firing through multiple cylinders, both internally and also there are external factors which are really supporting us. So when you have that much confidence and optimism around you, and the other last bit I would say is that, which is very unique this time and from what it was last time, was is most of the Indian corporates and Indian houses are actually deploying capital in India. What does that show again is there is a greater confidence of trying to invest in India. So all that leads to a lot of, you know, M&A activity, volume impetus. So I think it's, and you have, M&A is all about, you know, feeling good about it as well. It's as important as anything else. So I think when you have this optimism and confidence, you will see, you know, many, many more years of growth, and you will also see the volume kind of picking up. Yes, deals are taking time, which is one thing that we are observing in terms of M&A deals. But that's the nature of this business as well, that, you know, these are transformational decisions for any company. So sometimes they do take time. So yeah, that's in summary, I would say one is very positive, not only for this 1 year, I think it's for the several years to come, we will probably benefit out of what's happening in India.
No, that's very good to hear all the positivity around India, and to really hear it from experts like you who are right on the ground, who hear it from, domestic, sort of participants in the market and also internationally. That's very positive. How do you think, Naveen, all this positivity around business, economy, growth in India is translating to M&A market sentiment? Now, sometimes we hear that all of this means, M&A is going down, it's more greenfield, brownfield, but it's not M&A. Do you think this is really translating to a positive M&A sentiment?
Yeah. So every fair question, a very valid question. So look, I think we'll continue to have a fair bit of organic growth. I think that as a country, when you have to go from whatever $3.5 trillion to a $32 trillion economy in the next 25 years, you know, there will be a fair bit of organic growth that has to happen. But I think what is unique now is the amount of capital that is being deployed by private equity houses / sovereign wealth funds, i.e. the financial sponsors in India. And a lot of that capital is being deployed by them in buying businesses and building the businesses. So most of the transactions that you see, if a private equity house is buying that, he's buying with an objective that he would want to then build it to the next level. So it's a combination of M&A and then a bit of an organic growth. Now, what has that done is also is that we are in a way, in a very good virtuous cycle. Because if you have good capital markets where you can get good exits at a reasonably decent valuations, financial sponsors do get far more, you know, excited and positive about trying to transact an M&A, trying to buy a business and a financial sponsor wanting to sell the business because he's getting a decent value. So I think what we will see is the following, in my view. One, you will see a fair bit of activity continuing in the M&A side from the financial sponsors. Number two, at least the way we look at it is a lot of multinationals or a lot of the players who are sitting in Asia-Pac region or in Europe may want to try and transact in India, either in form of either putting up JVs or wanting to partner with, you know, players or wanting to even look at some acquisitions or taking some strategic positions which allow them to be in a long term and have a strong India position. So that is the second thing. The third thing that will happen and is happening actually, we are seeing a lot of multinationals, Indian subsidiaries are accessing capital markets. Now that also then gives you the currency to the Indian entity to be able to transact and acquire businesses, because then the valuation being punchy goes out of question, because your Indian entity is trading at a good value. And if you acquire something and you have stock as a consideration to give, that allows to transact. So I think it will of course be a bit of a cyclicality. M&A is a cyclical business in many ways. But if I see, because of all of these things, there are several stakeholders who will eventually continue doing things. And you're also seeing in some of the sectors where consolidation happening. Some of the sectors where, you know, international players are also saying, let me aggregate with others. We are seeing that in financial services, insurance and all of that. So I think it will all end up being a place where you will see a reasonably good amount of M&A activity going forward.
Very, very interesting, actually, some of your comments. And I think two, particularly one, what you make about consolidation and M&A leading to consolidation, and this being mixed, where players are looking at growth through M&A and otherwise. And the other very interesting thought you brought out was, multinationals IPOing or raising public capital through the Indian subsidiaries. And that is something we haven't seen for a long, long time. We've always seen multinationals wanting to delist, but now we are seeing a different market and that capital being deployed for M&A. So very interesting. And I think it throws up so many new opportunities.
If I can just add, Hargreaves, right? Naveen touched upon two of the things, right? I think what's also I would add on as a third lever. Naveen spoke about private equity. Naveen spoke about strategic interest in India. But what we are also seeing incrementally is domestic players now being much more amenable to large acquisitions. So frankly, it's three of the four levers which are fully at play, right? I mean, the only segment which we would argue is probably slightly slower is outbound acquisitions from India, which is still selective, just given the growth opportunities. But otherwise, I mean, three of the four levers are fully at play at this point of time.
Fantastic. No, great to hear that. I think we are all very enthusiastic and to get this view from you. Let's move, Prasanjit, to a slightly different topic. And if I may ask you, you know, what impact is ESG regulation having at present on M&A activity in India?
Right. Thanks, Agriv, and a very warm welcome to Naveen, Sundar, you and all the audience members who have joined in across the globe. ESG obviously, you know, is very, very critical in how it's shaping M&A landscape in India in terms of structuring, financing, valuation, integration, and all these fronts. And I will just deal each of them very briefly. I think firstly, let's be very clear. Today, when a global investor looks at an Indian company and shortlists a company, how the Indian company fares in terms of ESG compliance is definitely a relevant factor. So that's point number one. And if an Indian company is poor in terms of ESG compliance, I think it definitely does a great disservice to it if it's looking to make itself look appealing. Secondly, I think if an Indian company is ESG compliant, it also enhances its ability to command a premium from the foreign investor. As we know, valuation debate is often very tough and it's a tug of war between seller and buyer. And as a seller, you do a great deal of good to yourself if you are ESG compliant. So that's point number two. Point number three, from a buyer standpoint, and this is an acquisition finance point, it really helps quite tremendously as a buyer if you are looking to acquire or invest in an ESG compliant target to raise what you call green financing, you know, because your cost of financing reduces, which also enables you to bring down the cost of acquisition and thus the likelihood of that passing muster from the board or strategic or investor player increases. So that's point number three. Point number four is the from a target company. Now, this is slightly technical. The technical part is that now when you are assisting or a buyer in a due diligence exercise in deal making, increasingly we are witnessing that a lot of people are focusing on ESG diligence specifically. So for that, you A, must budget specific time, because if you have a limited exclusivity period in your timesheet and you did not really factor in this additional time, that may create some issues. B, you must have ESG experts who know the environmental social governance norms properly, the legislations, etc. C, the transaction documents will also have specific warranties and indemnities pertaining to ESG. So you will see that there are very specific warranties on anti-corruption, anti-bribery, which are separate and distinct from generic warranties. So they will have separate treatment in terms of what the consequences would be. So that's the third point, that when you're doing an M&A transaction, ESG factors also needs to be documented well, and focus and attention must be paid. So structuring, financing, and as a target to make yourself appealing on all these fronts, M&A continues, ESG continues to be a very, very significant factor in Indian M&A context.
Prasanjit, agree with that. In fact, one of the things which is certainly happening over the last 3 to 5 years and is the fact that because financial sponsors have become very active in doing, you know, buyout and growth deals, the amount of rigor that they bring in post acquisition of a smaller company on governance, on environment, on sustainability, on compliance and all of that, this has actually helped a lot these companies to elevate to the next level. So that is one. And secondly, when you take them to public market, that become much more easier. So the quality of the management that you bring in, the governance that you put into play, the focus. And that is also why, because a lot of these funds are governed by their global mandates, that you need to follow some of these specific measures. So I think ESG certainly helps you in many different ways to be a much better institution as a company. And as a result of that, you will see increasingly more confidence on M&A and potential listing of the targets.
Yeah, and just to clarify one part, which may not be directly within the ambit of this question, is ESG compliance is mandatory for, let's say, top 1,000 listed companies in India. But my advice to people who are watching this, promoter group who are promote basically in charge of unlisted companies, private companies, all the benefits which Naveen and I have articulated will do a world of good, because if you voluntarily comply with, a, let's say, a pro-labor policy or an environmental friendly policy, you will get a competitive advantage, which will eventually lead to more profitability, more revenue, better valuation. So they're all interlinked. So therefore, if you adopt voluntarily ESG good practices, it will help you in overall, not only smooth business running standpoint, more profitability, but also fetching better investors and buyers.
Thank you. Actually, quite pleasing to see how fast this market has moved. And we've been talking about ESG for a long time, but I certainly can see in my experience that this has become a serious topic. And you can definitely, as both of you have mentioned, get a quicker deal, more interest from investors, and perhaps a better valuation. And, in my experience, I've always told sort of small and mid-level seller companies to really put in the vendor report their ESG compliance as well, and not really wait for these issues being raised by potential bidders and then getting into the act of compliance. So very interesting to see how this market has moved. Naveen, you mentioned about, you brought out the point about financial sponsors. And financial sponsors, when they came to India, they came mostly taking minority positions, and they were in a way like participating as providing growth capital. Over a period of time, we've seen financial sponsors really play a sort of a leading role in M&A. And Sundar, if I may ask you, do you really see financial sponsors and private equity buyers remaining serious in the M&A market in 2024?
Absolutely, Hegley. I mean, and it's going to happen both from the capital availability and the growth part of it. What I mean by capital availability is when you look at the amount of capital which the private equity investors have raised, specifically the Asia pools of capital, which a lot of them have raised, there is a serious amount of capital which needs to be deployed in these markets. The relevance of India within the Asia Pacific market has just gone from strength to strength. What used to be, call it 10 to 15 or maybe 20% of Asia AUM, today for most private equity, that hovers probably at 30% at the lower end and probably north of 50% at the upper end for most private equity firms from an Asia AUM perspective. And at the end of the day, it's not just what is the percentage of AUM, right? I mean, is the market delivering returns? And when you sort of go back and look at it over the last 2-3 years, arguably some of the best exits globally for most of these private equity investors have happened out of India. And taking the points which are raised earlier, you have seen exits through capital markets, blocks, IPOs. You have seen exits by way of strategic sale, and you have seen exits by way of sale to other sponsors as well. So you have seen a diverse set of exits which private equity have been able to see. So one of the concerns which people used to have, call it in the mid-2010s, which was, yes, India has invested, but where are the exits? That's sort of gone away. And then when you sort of look at it from the perspective of corporates in India, when I'm now looking at it from the other side, people are also realizing, either for transition purposes, generational purposes, or in some instances, just for more value creation, sometimes it's good to have a large private equity partner who may come in and take a controlling stake. But even if I am at a minority position, if I'm creating more value, people are more open to it. So both from the intent of promoters to do deals, as well as from a capital availability and the fact that the track record of exits have been phenomenal. We think this is going to continue to play a big part. I mean, if I were to just think about it historically, I would say if you go back a few years, close to half of M&A volumes in India were driven by strategic inbound M&A, which are global acquirers. I would not be surprised if that number now moves to 50% by private equity investors.
No, I would just add to that is clearly, if you look at even some of these numbers, 60 to 70 odd billion dollars of investments annually, it's happening by the private equity shops right now. So which was used to be a substantially lower number, and exits are on 35, 40 billion. And you know, that kind of just shows that there is a good momentum of investments and exits that has got established. These deep capital markets, because now you not only have just the foreign institutional investors, but you have a large pool of domestic institutional investors very active in the market. As a result, any external shock gets absorbed well by the domestic institutional investors when FIIs are pulling out. What is that doing is giving stability to the equity capital market. And when it is giving that stability, the exits from the financial sponsors, from their companies by listing and then follow on block trades, gives them that confidence to continually do that. So that is point number one. The point number two, which has also significantly changed this time around, is that hiring management, hiring a team, and being able to deliver value is becoming consistently proven, which was not the case 8 to 10 years ago. So people are seeing that, look, if I buy this company, even from an existing promoter who is willing to exit because of succession issues or whatever it may be, I'll get a professional management, I'll incentivize them properly, I'll institutionalize that, and will I be able to deliver value? And there is serious amount of talent in the country at that level, at the KMP level, which is helping give that confidence to the private equity houses to do that. Plus, the third thing I would also say is that while you have the GPs who are doing all of this, they're also seeing outside of the fund also, you know, LPs wanting to partner with them and saying that, okay, if you want to take a big ticket, I'm willing to come and be part of that big ticket acquisition. So what does that do is it helps you to be able to do large buyout deals, which was not the case. The last thing I would say I've seen in some of the deals is couple of private equity houses coming together to do a large transaction if the check size is bigger. And even the financing market, the acquisition financing market, is also somewhere helping. Currently, one is seeing that as a bit of a difficulty. But having said that, that also has helped in many ways to make them as a very, very active player on the M&A, both on the buy and the sell side. And they'll continue to be doing that going forward. And that's what we have seen in the developed markets. And developed markets are all about financial sponsors. So I think we are going in that direction.
We're very fascinating to see how this market has so fast developed, you know, in our country. And Sundar, you made the point about, you know, promoters looking at a private equity exit even for better returns. I remember one transaction where private equity bought a significant majority, and the promoter was left with a very small minority, which he wanted to keep for future upside, and eventually exited that very small minority at a price greater than when he first sold the big chunk. And that really proves the point that, look, there's a lot of value which one can actually build together, partnering with private equity. But very fascinating to see this roll out in India. Let's move on to you, Naveen, and to Prasanjit. Let me ask you a sector question. How do you see M&A activity in India related to AI, artificial intelligence? So much has been talked about. Do you think that sector we will see M&A in India? And if so, where do you see that?
So maybe I'll start and then have Sanjeev come in. So look, as far as I think AI is concerned, it is not a sector, but it is effectively a horizontal cut across all the sectors. So that is for sure is one of the key things that is going to transform the way we operate, the way we do business, the way we execute business, the way we, you know, engage with customers, clients, and all of that. So I think clearly that is transformational. Having said that, I would also say at the same time is that a lot of use cases that have to be still developed on AI are still at an evolution stage. So I think a lot of investment is going on. A lot of, you know, startups are investing in it. A lot of large players are investing in it. But as far as India is concerned, I would say we are not seeing too much of AI-driven transactions, okay, large or medium-sized transactions at this stage, because each of these large corporates or large business houses or even large businesses are creating, you know, strong in-house teams. They call it the AI Center of Excellence, and they will have AI business champions and wanting to get AI ready. So how do they collate data? How do they curate data? How do they create, you know, all of that framework that is required for them eventually, which will benefit their businesses, create those use cases and be able to deliver those unit economics that potentially will lead to some benefits to the underlying business. So I think it is more at the build-up stage. What potentially you will see is the infrastructure around AI. You will see transactions around that, data infrastructure, cloud services, and all of that. And even in tech services, people are kind of watching what is the implication of AI on tech services. So I think it is something where over time you will see a lot of activity happening globally. Of course, we have seen how Mag 7 valuations have gone up on the back of AI. And the fact is, of course, they are putting in a lot of capital, R&D capital. They are doing a lot of acquisitions and JVs and partnerships to build the capabilities of AI globally. And that's what is also running up their valuations. But really, if you cut the chase and look at the core, have those really been very value accretive? The answer is no. It is all in the investment mode. And as we have seen, anything that is new and anything that is transformational, you will see several billions of dollars first getting invested and then potentially value getting created later and M&A coming in later to kind of consolidate. So that's how I see it.
I mean, I completely agree. And I think just to supplement you, I will touch upon a different aspect, which is from a legal standpoint. How does AI impact M&A transactions per se? Now, I think as you can see, right from the inception, again, of scouting for targets, a lot of AI is being used and deployed to cut through a slew of companies and focus on the ones which has the right ROCE, right debt equity ratio, so on and so forth. So that's where AI is being deployed very immensely, I would say, more than ever before. Lawyers are also increasingly using AI, let's say, to review voluminous diligence documents, expediting the deal timelines by really using technology. So again, AI comes into play in so far as truncating the deal timelines in an M&A scenario. So both, I think the scouting process and B, the use of AI in truncating deal timelines, making the whole experience more efficient, I think we will see increasingly a lot of emphasis in these two areas. And of course, what Naveen mentioned is right. It's still a, I would say, nascent phase where a lot of investments will happen, definitely should happen, but today it's still evolving as we speak.
No, thanks for that completely different perspective on AI, Prasanjit. Well, we've talked a lot about the good and all the opportunities and what's happening. Now let's move to some of the obstacles. So Sundar and Prasanjit, if I may ask you, what do you see as the major obstacles to you know, closing M&A deals in 2024? Over to you, Sundar.
Yeah, so Hegrave, I mean, we spoke about all the positive, right? So the all the underlying trends seem to suggest things should all be good from an India perspective. But when things are good, which means you have more competition, right? So, and the competition for M&A is going to be public markets, right? So invariably, in a lot of M&A conversations, we would expect the sellers to think about, should we do a sale? Should we consider an IPO option, which is going to be more better, et cetera? So that those considerations will definitely continue to play at the back of the mind of people. I mean, frankly, we spoke about how things are looking good for M&A, but equally all things are looking good, even from a capital market perspective, right? So that healthy debate and healthy competition between these would continue. Frankly, outside of this, do I think there could be other factors which sort of impede M&A? Not much. I mean, you could say if the geopolitical tensions continue to flare up, things could slow down a bit. One could always hope for the regulatory approval processes to be quicker than what it is. But I would say these are all things which one should be used to in a developing economy like India, which is sort of continuing to sort of grow at a rapid pace, right? So none of those, I would say, would really come in the way, but some healthy competition between M&A and capital markets will likely play out.
Thank you, Sundar.
I think I completely agree with Sundar. I think nothing extraordinary we foresee, which will create a special bottleneck. I think if I have to be very specific and pushed, I would say competition law is one law in 2023. Some amendments have been carried out, which have been perceived by many as enhancing the ambit of competition law authorities. Now, I'm sure the intent was good, but as we all know, the intent to, you know, hell is paved, always good intent. You know, so I think the point is, the intent is very good, but if the authorities sit on an application for extended time, and therefore prolonging the deal timelines, it can have a, you know, negative and adverse impacts. I think that's one specific law I would say we'll have to wait and watch. It's a recent law, recent change, and how that evolves. But barring that, yes, I think the cost of financing can increase if there are, you know, geopolitical issues, inflation, that can have an impact. I would say businesses' valuations may tumble because, let's say, of cost of manufacturing going up because of cost of import going high, you know, because of the geopolitical issues. So that can have an impact. The IT sector is currently languishing. You know, if country X, which feeds a lot of IT work in India, that itself is struggling, so the growth will stagnate. So I think those kind of challenges in valuation may stymie a lot of deal activity, but I think those are momentary and we'll have to wait and watch. But largely I agree there's nothing too worrisome at this stage. I think on legal standpoint, competition was the only one which I think we should wait and watch.
Well, very positive and good to hear. So let me ask Naveen you one more question. Whether you think the current political climate and upcoming elections, how would that potentially influence M&A activity in India?
So I think at least the way the investors or the market is right now viewing is that, and hopefully that is right, is that the elections is more a foregone conclusion. Hopefully the existing government should you know, potentially come in power is generally the view of the market and the investor community. So I think that optimism and stability, the positive optimism of having a stable government is already baked into the any process that we are running or anybody else is running, is that will that change the direction of the company's growth, or will that change the direction of the, you know, the company's momentum that they are, you're seeing either on profitability, all of that? The answer is really no. So I think that is it's very unique again here. Having said that, I would also say here is that M&A is a function of how effective is also your cost of capital. Now there, if you had to now go outside of India and look at the political landscape and look at what's really happening, if you really see some statistics, is more than 50% of the world's population, where it decides, these countries are going for election in this year. It's a very unique year in that sense. And some of these elections are very, very going to be very, very instrumental, like the US elections, what finally happens and how does that affect. I think the other thing which really is happening because of the way various key economies are engaging with each other. Okay, so there are some 3-4 large trends, if I would say. One is the whole remilitarization of the world. Now there is increasingly everybody is wanting to spend more and more on making themselves more and more strong on the military front. Number two, the whole global trade and agreements are all getting restructured. The number three, I would say, is the entire spending on making a new and green economy is also expensive. Means there is a cost associated with that. Then ongoing fiscal, you know, this spending, all of these are all inflationary. Now, if these are all inflationary, then effectively you are in a regime today and likely to continue in a high interest environment. While people do anticipate, hopefully, that in the second half of this year, there may be some rate cuts happening. But whatever we heard last week, it looks like potentially it could be a question mark. Now, if your interest costs are going to be higher, then your financing costs are higher. And if your financing costs are higher, it definitely has an impact on your M&A, right? So I think when you can't decouple India from what's happening in the world. Whatever we may say as a country, we are doing fine, we are doing all good, which is all very good. And in a relative term, certainly we are, but you can't decouple. So to your point, I would say when I'm looking at the political environment in India, we are at a far stable footing. But when we are looking at political environment globally, whatever is happening in Russia, Ukraine, China, you know, US elections coming, UK elections coming, all of that, with what's happening with Germany today, means we never thought of Germany getting into a almost 0% growth or recession. Actually, people talk about those numbers are actually recessionary. So, and also because of the energy costs, the way they have gone up there. So all these things add up to the mix about the fact that financing is going to be expensive and that will have a bearing on the bill. So that's something is a challenge.
Right. Yeah, I think just to supplement, Naveen, just two quick points. A, I think if you look at, again, the assumption to my, what I'm saying is that the current dispensation will come back to power. I think that's an assumption we can safely make. B, is that if you look at the manifesto issued by the current government, they are clearly focusing on infrastructure, defense, you know, train. So you can see and witness where the focus of the government will be in the next 100 days and post elections, etc. So again, these are sectors which are very much need of the hour and need a lot of capital investment. So again, we can witness a lot of M&A activity in these sectors. So that's one, which is on the positive side. B, see, eventually, we are not obviously, you know, kind of somebody who can predict the future accurately. And therefore, when we negotiate deal documents today, 3-4 key points have to be kept in mind. Please have your force majeure clause appropriately worded. If there is a long interim period between signing and closing, do the risk allocation package in a manner that if, let's say, things turn out to be unexpected, that and the sector is impacted because of policy reversals, you have appropriate measures in the agreement which gives you get out of jail kind of a scenario. So that's point number two. Point number three, if there are conditions precedent like regulatory approval, don't wait till cows come home, expedite the process before the election season kicks in and election result pans out. Try and get those approval out of the way at the earliest so that, you know, you are not dependent and contingent on the outcome of the election. You take control of your destiny as much as you can. So those are 3-4 points I will make from my standpoint.
No, very, very useful tips indeed, Prasanjit. And Naveen, great perspective about, you know, India not being decoupled. And I think we always think of India, yes, India shining, India opportunity, all of it. But at the end, the world is one. So that's also a great insight, actually. Sundar, over to you. Let's look at valuations. And given current market dynamics, especially in India, how do you expect deal valuations from a M&A perspective? And any thoughts around deal structuring trends which will evolve, you think, in 2024 to address some of the valuation issues?
Sure. So, I mean, I think valuations in India have always should always be viewed in the context of the expected growth rate, right? On an absolute basis, the multiples in India always are much higher than what it is elsewhere. You don't need to look beyond some of the global MNCs which have listed subsidiaries in India and which will sort of clearly articulate that difference. Having said that, yes, I mean, that does mean people have to underwrite sustainable growth to sort of justify these multiples. What we think will likely happen is people will likely get comfort on some of this growth. However, a couple of variants could sort of crop up. One, we think to the extent people have a listed vehicle in India, we think people are likely increasingly going to try and use their currency as a vehicle for acquisition. So using stock for acquisitions, that's one. Two, within the private equity universe, we think as people are thinking about monetizations, we think partial recap or co-control situations could play out. Some of those have played out. Just like we said, how people will underwrite continued growth. Some of the sellers may also have visibility on continued growth. So compared to 100% sale, could they think about a scenario, can we do a 50% sale and a new investor comes in? And there have been a few of those deals which have sort of played out over the last few years on the IT services side. So some of these trends will likely continue. And the third is we also expect increased relevance for some of the direct capital providers, which are the LPs, which are the sovereigns, pension funds, etc., who arguably solve for a slightly lower cost of capital for a slightly lower risk profile. They would sort of tend to play an important role. So that's broadly what I would sort of say in terms of structures.
I will just add from a legal standpoint, and this goes back to the previous point on political climate, uncertainties, and this valuation. I think, Hargreave, you will see a lot of increased use of deferment, escrows, holdbacks. So that is the best mitigant to bridge the valuation gap debate, where you know two parties are diametrically on opposite sides for obvious conflicting reasons. So I think you will see that escrows and holdbacks will be increasingly used more in structuring. I think that's the only supplementary point I wanted to make to this point.
No, thank you. Thank you. I know that we have now about 10 minutes more for our webinar. And let me move to some of the audience questions. We've got some very interesting audience questions.
We have time till 3:30, and 3:30 we can take audience questions. We have 10 minutes.
Okay, so I think we have, we can do a few more questions before we move to the audience questions. So let's look at one more perspective on Indian M&A. Do you foresee, Naveen, when we talk about Indian M&A, cross-border M&A, where I think you did remark, but Indian companies going abroad on M&A transactions, do you see that still active and continuing to be active in 2024? How do you see that market from an Indian M&A perspective?
So look, I think what has certainly changed this time from the last time around was that it's far more inbound and far more domestic than cross-border going out and acquiring businesses, which was the trend, if I would say, 5-7 years ago. Having said that, you will always see very select transactions happening wherein Indian companies are going and acquiring companies for 2-3 reasons. One is either they want access to that market, and as a result, they are able to capitalize on their products, their businesses in India, make it in a very cost efficient way, and be able to sell those products in the global markets. So access to market is one driver. The other is potentially is access to technology and know-how. Now, what you are seeing is in some of the sectors, some of the other countries and geographies are far ahead on technology and know-how. So can you acquire a company and be able to then ensure that the technology and know-how, you bring it to India and then you build it at scale. So you're not only benefiting out of the understanding and the growth of the market in which you've acquired, but you're able to transfer those skills and capabilities and products and know-how into India to build that at scale, because India is still a pretty, under-penetrated market across sectors. So that is the second trend that one is effectively likely to see. The third thing I would say here is that in terms of cross-border, you will largely also see inbound, meaning a foreign strategics and foreign players wanting to come to India. And a lot of it potentially will not be 100% transactions, because one of the things that a lot of these foreign players have understood it very well is that India is a complex market. India is a very deep and broad market. So you need a domestic player or a domestic partner whom with you you can partner and grow and build the business. So we are seeing a lot of activity right now in India, Japan and other corridors where people are wanting to come and take strategic positions and grow the business and on the back of the India growth story. So I would say it will be there, but it will be something which will be not of the same magnitude that we have seen in the past. It will be select and a fair bit of inbound as well.
Actually, very insightful. You mentioned that, Naveen, because when India liberalization started, we saw a spate of joint ventures, and then it was really where there were buyouts and joint ventures were being terminated, where foreigners and multinationals were just buying out their Indian partners. And I think in this phase, we are seeing joint ventures once again, which is very positive. And notwithstanding the point you made on much better senior talent availability in India, ease in regulations in India, the ability for foreigners to acquire entirely and control businesses in India or even financial sponsors, yet there is value seen to joint ventures. And I don't think I can tell you from our firm's perspective, we haven't seen a more busier time in negotiating joint ventures in the recent past than now. And that's been quite a phenomenon. So I really share what you have expressed in terms of the sentiment around joint ventures in India. Let's look at one more very important aspect, maybe PC and Sundar, if you can comment upon. And how do you think, specifically geopolitical tensions, trade agreements, barriers, duties will affect cross-border M&A involving Indian companies? It'll be very interesting to get your perspective on this.
Sundar, you want to go first? Or?
Yeah, sure. So maybe I can just talk about from a corporate activity, right? I mean, I completely agree with the point that while we all like to believe India's decoupled, I think in the world is still one place and we all need to sort of coexist, right? So I think that goes without saying. However, if I were to sort of take one thing out of the current geopolitical situation, it is people are increasingly looking at diversification out of one single geography from a supply chain perspective, manufacturing perspective, et cetera. And clearly that is leading to increased investments on the manufacturing side in India. Think about any manufacturing sector, industrial sector. There's a lot of activity. Now, a lot of this could be organic growth. People make new investments to growth, but we also think there will be relevant M&A activity, which sort of picks up. So when I think about it from an M&A perspective, this will lead to, in some ways, an increasing share of manufacturing contribution to the GDP from what it is currently. So that's the way I would sort of think about it at this point of time.
Right. I think, again, just supplements from the, I think, again, the whole, see, if there's uncertainty, it's one united world. The more uncertainty exists, people will be more reticent, reluctant to invest. That's obvious, goes without saying. I think, but having said that, I mean, if you look at in Indian context, because of our border skirmishes, specifically with China, and we're not blessed with great neighbors, and we had to really come up with a law which basically meant any investment from China directly or indirectly, or anybody sharing land border, needs prior approval. And that was a straight away outcome of a geopolitical issue. Similarly, today, let's say two countries, X and Y, are at loggerheads, and India is expected to take sides. Now, India, thankfully, has not taken sides at all with any skirmish. They have maintained a great posture of neutrality, not supporting any negative cause, but not taking sides. Now, if you take sides, again, you will fall out of favor from an investment standpoint of many countries. So one has to strike a right balance on these geopolitical issues so that you don't shut out door from foreign investment of any particular country. FDI is welcome from all countries, in my view. So I think that's point number two. I think the thirdly, I think the trade agreement point, I think it's obviously, I know India and UK were having some trouble to close out the trade agreement, but I think the more enabling trade agreements you have with multiple countries, you will encourage back and forth reciprocity in terms of investment, acquisition in even their countries. I think Sundar touched upon the self-reliance point of supply chain. Now, you know, COVID taught us this great lesson. If you're self-reliant, and that can be achieved not only in making India, but also acquiring, let's say, companies which are in the same vertical abroad, and they definitely augment your supply chain. So all of this, I would say, are factors which should be kept in mind, you know, in terms of the current geopolitical dynamic situation and trade agreement. Right.
Thank you, Sundar and Prithi. I think we'll take one more question before moving to the audience questions. And Naveen, you mentioned about you know, international interest rates and finance being also very important element in determining M&A activity. What do you think is the outlook for the Indian interest rates in 2024, and how will sort of financing, debt financing in India affect Indian M&A?
So two things. One is, I would say, in terms of the interest cost in India, generally, I would put it is that the way inflation is happening globally with where crude prices are and where we are kind of heading, I don't think we are in a place where we will end up in kind of a very low interest rate environment. I think interest rates are there where they are, in fact, and they are only going to be, the cost of borrowing is not going to come down. So I think that is one point I would want to make. The second thing is, in India, as you know, acquisition financing has its own restrictions and own limitations, the way it goes about doing it. So I think from that perspective, there are structures. People have figured out structures where people are able to get financing done and be able to, you know, work through that. And there's a lot of private credit also, you know, coming in right now in a big way, because there are separate dedicated private credit funds also wanting to support structured, you know, instruments to be able to provide that additional financing power for trying to execute the transactions, whether it is for promoters or for even other situations. So I think I would say here is that it is not a big issue, but at the same time, I don't think it is going to be a big trigger to accelerate any M&A as such. I think what we are in this current situation, the cost is not going to be coming down, is my interest cost.
Thank you. Thanks for that perspective. Let's move to some very interesting audience questions that have come. One of the questions is, what are the sectors that you experts foresee will have the most M&A activity in 2024 in India, and why do you think so? So maybe Sundar and Naveen, over to you. You all are the experts.
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, I think in general, what I would say is that activity is pretty strong across sectors. So I don't want to sort of pull out one sector, but anything which is linked to the domestic consumption, in some ways, we're seeing a lot of activity. And that doesn't necessarily mean just consumer, but think about healthcare, pharma, healthcare services. That sector has been pretty active. Industrials, for the reasons we spoke about, has been active. And in a growth economy, obviously, you would expect the financial services sector to be active. So it's a bit generic statement. I'm sort of picking off all the sectors, but frankly, that's the way. I mean, we are seeing activity across a lot of sectors today.
Yeah, no, Sundar, I agree. I think I'll add one or two other sectors would be infrastructure. I think infrastructure, energy, where we are seeing, you know, again, M&A happening. There are several players who are wanting to, you know, churn the portfolio of their renewable energy for various reasons. And some of them are very interestingly also international strategic players revisiting their India strategy when it comes to to the energy businesses and platforms that they have created, and also given the fact that with the number of infra funds that we have, you would see the activity even in the infrastructure sector. And technology always has been something where you will continue to see M&A in because again it has a significant dominance of even financial sponsors there. So I would say, just to add to what Sundar mentioned, I would add these two other sectors as well.
Actually, you know, again, something which has become a recent phenomenon is M&A in the infrastructure. If you really look at a decade ago, we didn't have enough infra built businesses for M&A activity. And how the market has changed, where today infra M&A has become a major sector for M&A activity. Just over how many infra assets have gotten built over the last two decades across sectors. And it's very heartening to see that today infra investment is not just happening in greenfield, but also M&A and M&A assets are being used as platforms to expand in the infra sector.
No, and agree. Well, I would add one more interesting thing which we had not seen at all. Something like NHAI creating a platform of InvIT and then getting sovereign wealth funds and financial sponsors coming and investing billions of dollars is fantastic. You know, I mean, this just shows that there is so much that you can do. You know, and there is capital wanting to, you know, be deployed on these high quality assets, and there are so many assets that will keep building up, right? We are seeing a lot of deals around how, you know, warehouses and supply chain and distribution centers, all of those being, you know, either carved out or being created, where you will, you know, effectively create transactions out of it. So I think, yes, infrastructure will continue to have its own share of activity for years to come.
Yeah. And you mentioned NHAI. I'd also mention, you know, NIIF. Who would think of NIIF as a fund with government participation to do what it's doing in the infrastructure, you know? But sorry, Sundar, I interrupted you. You were sharing some thoughts.
No, I agree. I mean, I think it's also how the markets have evolved, right? I mean, I think if you were to sort of go back 15 years, as you rightly said, the assets were still in a development stage, and the risks are oftentimes very difficult for a lot of new investors to underwrite. As the market has evolved, you now have a framework where the investors can underwrite an appropriate risk-reward framework, right? I mean, if you have a completed asset, the risk which you're taking is more reasonable, and you solve for a lower return at that point of time. So the regulations have evolved, assets have been developed, and there's policy certainty, all of which is sort of feeding onto this.
Oh, thank you. Thanks for that very positive environment comment. So I'm going to ask you both, Naveen and Sundar, a very tough question for your views. So 2024, do you think local buyers or foreign buyers will dominate the Indian M&A activity? Naveen, what do you think?
So in my view, it will be the financial sponsors slash private equity houses, which are, you know, a mix of domestic and foreign private equity houses, will clearly dominate the M&A activity in my view.
And what do you think, Sundar?
I think each of these are going to be there, but what I can tell you is I think the global strategic interest into India, assuming no new geopolitical shocks, will possibly surprise us on the upside. So global inbound M&A.
Super. I think we have lots of audience questions which we won't be able to take up. We have some questions on specific transactions which unfortunately we are not able to deal with and answer specific cases. But there's one very interesting question which I want to ask you, PC. And this comes from an associate who's very early in his career. And he asks that should he bet on the Indian M&A PE market by staying in India or should he go to the Middle East where the market is also very positive, and there are sovereign wealth funds who are very active. And what would your advice be to a young M&A lawyer? What should he do?
I think without a doubt, India. I think there's no question about it. I think multiple reasons. I think we have already discussed the bullish sentiment around India, Indian M&A, and China plus one and whatnot. And I think the growth has just begun. I think there is a 2047 vision which the current Prime Minister has. I think there will be enormous scope in India as a M&A professional per se to multiply and accelerate your growth to unforeseen and unprecedented levels. So while other countries are also good, but the growth perhaps has plateaued. And I think in India, we are just beginning to really showcase our true potential and ability. So my answer, absolutely yes, India.
Thank you. Thanks for that advice. I'm sure the young associates and other lawyers who are hearing this will benefit a lot. So I think that is bringing us to an end of our Q&A. Prasanjit, can I ask you to give us three key takeaways from today's webinar that you think are pertinent to the M&A outlook for 2024?
Sure, I think this is the most toughest question with so many points being made. Just to come down to three, I think will be tough. But I think let me recap at least what I can. I've made some notes, but I think some brilliant points being made by Naveen and Sundar. I think firstly, let's be very clear, the sentiment around the economy, M&A, is all bullish. That's point number one. If there's any country in the world, you know, you look at whether it's China plus one or any other large economies, growing economies, India features in all discussions. So that's a very, very heartening sign. Number two, of course, does it mean that the path is absolutely crystal clear? This is a year which has few uncertainties. The geopolitical part we have discussed at length. How the world behaves itself, reacts itself, is very important to some of the tensions, you know, which will unfold. And no country will be left untouched if the world, you know, reacts in a particular way. So that's an important factor, I would say. Second is, I would say, what is also important, as we have seen, is our elections. While we all agree, I think that the current dispensation should come back to power with a resounding victory. But if it doesn't happen for whatever reasons, I think one has to be slightly cautious. So I'm very optimistic, but cautiously optimistic on that front. I think third is that companies, they should embrace technology, AI, ESG, these kind of steps voluntarily, proactively, rather than reactively, because that will give them the competitive advantage, increase the premium valuation, etc., etc. So that's the third one, I will say, which is very important, which I think is there. Fourthly, I think we should also take heart from the fact that it's not only FII, but DII participation, which is really going the, you know, kind of helping the M&A momentum, whether in terms of increasing valuation and allowing listed companies to do further acquisitions using its own stock as a consideration, etc. And lastly, I would say from a deal structuring standpoint, given some of these uncertainties, I think expert advice should be taken on structuring devices like earnout, which are notoriously difficult to draft. And therefore, advice should be taken on these issues. So those will be five key takeaways in my view. I may not have done justice, but I think that's the best I could do.
You've done exceedingly well for that very crisp and insightful summary, Prasanjit. Thank you. So, well, thank you, Sundar, Naveen, Prasanjit, for all your thoughts. Before closing, I would like to ask each one of you to respond to the poll slide on your screen. This is for the audience to provide your feedback on today's webinar. We take this very seriously as part of our continuous improvement program. Finally, I would like to thank each one of our guests for sharing the experience and expertise with us today. Sundar, Naveen, Prasanjit, thank you very much. Without you, this webinar would not have been possible. Each one of you did an outstanding job, and we are very much indebted to you. To our audience, I hope you found the webinar interesting and a worthwhile investment of your time. We certainly enjoyed bringing it to you. After the webinar, we will send you a copy of today's presentation material, summary notes, and a link to the recording. You'll also separately receive a request for your feedback on the webinar. Please take time to send it to us. Comments, criticism, and even compliments. The form takes less than a minute to complete. Please do not hesitate to contact us regarding any matters arising from the webinar. Our contact information is on the contact slide at the end of the webinar. Thank you for your attendance today, and we look forward to being of service again at future webinars. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Always a pleasure speaking to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.